There's little doubt that most of us never imagined going about our daily lives wearing a mask. But here we are. Is there an end in sight, or is the new normal now just normal? Let's ask in the nation's capital, Raywat Deonandan. He's an epidemiologist and associate professor in the Faculty of Health Sciences at the University of Ottawa, and he makes occasional, one might even say regular, appearances on this program to explain the inexplicable to us from time to time. Dr. D, it's good to see you again. How are you doing?
I'm doing great. Thanks for having me back.
Glad to see it. Is it time, in your judgment, now that 80% of us are apparently vaxxed, to get rid of wearing masks?
No, it's not time. We're still in the midst of a wave, and we still have a fair number of people who are unvaccinated. We still have case numbers climbing, and we have to use all the tools at our disposal to curtail transmission. And possibly the simplest, least expensive, best return on investment tool that we have is mask wearing. So it's not yet time to ditch that particular tool.
How often in your travels do you have people say to you, you know, it's been about 19 or 20 months of wearing these things, and I'm sick of it, and I really don't want to do it anymore?
You know, it used to be more common to hear that earlier in the pandemic. I think people have become a little bit accustomed to having to use it. And now you feel almost naked if you don't wear one, if you're going indoors with people that you trust, for example, or taking it off when eating at a restaurant, you might feel a little bit exposed. So we can become accustomed to the strangest things as human beings.
It's really funny how it depends on where you are. I still see considerable mask wearing outdoors. We're in Midtown Toronto right now. I see a lot of people still wearing masks outside. Do you recommend that still?
I don't recommend that. No, there's no need for that, frankly. But if it makes you feel safer and it signals to other people that you take this disease seriously, that has a social relevance and value. And also, as the winter months come, it can keep your face warmer. So there is an additional benefit to wearing masks outside, but not for curtailing COVID, in my opinion.
And what do you say to people who are not yet convinced? I don't know why they wouldn't be, but there are some people who are not yet convinced that this virus is contractible through the air, and therefore you should wear a mask.
Yeah, that's a big one, right? So many of the experts were slow to come on board with this way of thinking as well. I think now we're at the point where the consensus opinion, belief, conclusion is that COVID is airborne. Not just airborne, but probably aerosol transmission is the dominant mode of transmission. And that's a big statement. The reasons we know that to be true is, in addition to the laboratory studies on things like animals being deliberately exposed to an aerosol-generating ordeal and showing infection that way, we have some evidence from the real world. We have people in quarantine hotels and in cruise ships who are sequestered in their own rooms, not coming into contact with people, and yet still becoming infected because of a shared ventilation system. We have situations in hospitals, for example, where people are wearing masks regularly, a certain quality mask, which I think we could talk about later on, and yet still become infected because COVID is airborne. We have situations when people become infected by other people who have left the premises but have exhaled infectious particles and that linger in the air longer. That is the signature of aerosol airborne transmission. So that's the reality we're in right now.
You mentioned quality of masks, so let's pick up on that right now. I have seen everything from people wearing the sort of bottom of the barrel cloth mask to N95s to some people who just actually take their scarf and hike it up over their face and just cover their face with their scarf. And I guess they think that does the job. Do you want to comment on the advisability of all three options?
Okay, first of all, any mask is better than no mask. That's pretty obvious. There are studies, simulation studies, that show the relative contribution value of those quality of masks that you talked about, and depending on who's wearing it, the source, the potentially infectious person, or the receiver, the potentially person who's receiving infection, and depending upon who's wearing what, the time it takes to receive an infectious dose varies. And I phrase that a certain way, right? Because we're not saying that mask wearing is going to guarantee that you won't be infected. What we're saying is mask wearing diminishes the probability substantially that you'll be infected. So the cloth masks, the scarf, that doesn't do a whole lot. If this disease were transmitted by large droplets that emerge from your respiratory system and fall to the ground within 2 meters, then those kinds of masks might trap those droplets and prevent it from going those full 2 meters. The three-ply mask, the surgical mask, do a better job of curtailing aerosols and droplets, but they're baggy around the sides of your mouth, and so they're escaping from the sides and tops and bottoms. If you imagine an aerosolized disease like cigarette smoke, so cigarette smoke is an aerosol particle, and imagine someone smoking behind a scarf. Does the smoke get through the scarf? It does. Not all of it, but most of it does. If you're imagining someone smoking from behind a surgical mask, does the smoke get through the mask? Much of it doesn't, but a lot of it comes through the sides, tops, and bottoms. Now, if someone's wearing a fitted mask, like an N95, how much of it gets through and how much of it escapes from the sides? Not a lot. So in an aerosol milieu, in the reality of an aerosol airborne virus, the fitted mask is the best possible protection, and I think that's what everyone should strive to wear.
Okay, so that's the best option, the N95. Does that mean that you are advocating that everybody go out and start wearing N95s, budget allowing?
Yeah, I am. Now, when I say N95, I'm talking about a family of masks. The specific N95 high caliber medical grade tested mask is best for healthcare workers, and you might have a difficult time finding them. And the N95 has passed certain standards that are relevant for American and Canadian healthcare operation. But there are other things in the family, like the KN95s, for example, which pass the Chinese standard, but are just as good for you and I to wear. They're not fit tested. Healthcare workers have to have them fit tested to make sure they're sealed around your mouth. But you and I, it's okay if they're just snug against your mouth. I think everyone should wear that caliber, that quality of mask. I do. My family does.
You do under what circumstances?
All the time.
All the
Whenever
time?
Whenever I'm going indoor, well, not I'm going to bed, but if I'm going indoors in places with people whose status, infectious status, I'm not aware of, like grocery stores or stores of any kind, yeah, I wear an N95 caliber mask.
Gotcha. Okay, good to know. All right, I'm going to set up this next question by saying I refuse to confirm or deny whether or not the circumstances I'm about to describe apply to yours truly. But let's just say, for argument's sake, that in a family where everybody's negative, right? Nobody's got COVID. Maybe some mask sharing happened on occasion because somebody didn't notice that the initial that was put on the mask wasn't his initial, but maybe belonged to somebody. Anyway, you get the drift here. This is obviously not advisable, but is it harmful?
Honestly, if it's in your own family, people you live in a house with, you're already sharing each other's aerosols and germs and everything else. Sharing a mask is not going to cause a much increase in risk, to my mind. My spouse and I have shared masks inadvertently as well. Don't tell her that. She's probably hearing this for the first time. I don't think that's a big deal. Remember, the point here is to protect yourself from other people's exhalations and to protect others from your exhalations. By sharing a mask, you're not protecting each other from each other. But presumably, you're already not protecting each other from each other because you're sharing other intimate aspects of your life.
Got it. Okay. Good. I think that makes me feel a little bit better. But anyway, but I'm not the only idiot out there who's done that. Sorry, I didn't mean to. No.
Oh, I'm totally on board with
that. Let me, again, this is a bit of an odd one. But, you know, we have these cloth masks as part of our lives now as never before. And eventually, you know, after a few uses, I guess they're ending up in the garbage. This may not be your area of expertise, but are we kind of setting ourselves up for an environmental problem down the road that we hadn't anticipated because, you know, we're throwing out all these cloth masks now?
Oh, it does fill me with great sadness when I'm walking the dog and I see piles of discarded masks on the floor. Mm-hmm. Reminds me of the cigarette butt era from the 70s when people just toss cigarette butts everywhere. It's not ideal. It's not great. I don't think there's any way to get around the fact that this pandemic is having a deleterious aspect on the climate, the environment in general, and mask wearing in particular, because these are high-tech materials they're made of. The N95s are made of polypropylene, for example. I don't know how well that decays. There are some studies suggesting that you can wash them to a certain number of times for reuse. Maybe heating them to a certain temperature can kill the germs sufficiently to allow you to reuse them. So there are ways to, I think, to minimize the impact, but I don't think there's a way to get around the fact that this is going to be bad for the environment in some capacity.
Do you see a lot of that happening? Because I know, now admittedly, I'm in the middle of the biggest city in the country here. I see masks discarded on the side of the streets every day. And it does kind of surprise me and borderline tick me off. What do you say when you What do you think when you see it?
I think I can't wait for this to be over so that we don't see this anymore. And also, I wish people just had a better respect for their environment and for the technologies that we are investing in them to protect them. So do you throw tissues away on the street after you've blown your nose? Some people do. Most people don't. So this is kind of the same thing. It's not exactly biological hazard, but it shows a fundamental disrespect for the communal good.
Okay, let me come at this story now from a different angle, which is to say, I guess it was right near the beginning when we didn't know a whole lot, and when we got parcels coming to our home, and we got mail coming to our home, or, you know, if we used a door in public, we were very careful to wash the mail, wash the parcels, leave our shoes outdoors on the front stoop for a few days before bringing them inside. I mean, we did a lot of stuff. In hindsight, was all of that pointless?
Well, was it pointless? On a social level, no. It showed the extent to which we can conform to public health guidance. It probably curtailed transmission of the flu and the common cold and other respiratory viruses to a large extent. It was the right thing to do in absence of solid evidence otherwise. But yes, it may have been pointless because that's not how you curtail the spread of COVID. You curtail the spread of COVID by controlling an aerosol disease, which means high-quality mask wearing, ventilation, and air filtration. Those are the best tools, in addition to testing and vaccination. Even social distancing and plexiglass barriers and stuff aren't the high impact tools that we need as much as mask wearing and ventilation.
And let me do a follow-up on mask wearing. I don't know if you notice this, but I certainly do. I notice a lot of people who still wear masks up to here, and they leave their noses exposed because, let's be honest, it's a lot easier to breathe when the mask isn't covering your nose than when it is. I don't know if they're doing that because they don't know how to wear it properly or because they've just decided, you know, half the face is enough. Do you see this?
Oh, I see it all the time. And I think when it's a function of wanting to comply with the guidance to the letter, but not to the spirit. So the letter says you must wear this thing around your face to gain entry into the store. But really the point of it is that to prevent the spread of exhaled aerosols and hopefully to some extent prevent you from inhaling someone else's aerosols. We produce these small droplets from our respiratory system and they are exuded from our mouth and our nose. So it's important to prevent that from happening. I don't know what to tell people other than to tell them, do you breathe solely out of your mouth? I don't think so, most people.
Right, okay. Let me ask you about schools, because, of course, the province of Ontario has insisted that it has flowed funds in order to make sure that our schools have better ventilation and that, therefore, they not become breeding grounds for COVID-19. Based on what you know, is that in fact happening?
Oh, I don't know if it's happening. I've heard stories from some schools that have taken measures. I think they're in the minority. And frankly, I know of schools with like windows painted shut, for example. You can't even get a cross breeze in there. It's probably a fair investment to upgrade a filtration system to the high quality MERV 14 and 16 standards. If that means anything, it's an engineering term. I'm not an engineer. There are things they can do. These things called Corsi Rosenthal boxes that you can make in your home. You take some furnace filters of a certain quality, you slap them together and create a cube, and that is sufficient to filter out air in a room the size of a classroom. That's been shown in several simulation studies in the USA. So we're not doing everything that we can do to curtail this disease, especially now that we accept that it's airborne. And I can't say that enough. For the longest time, those are dirty words, but COVID is airborne and we have to accept that and run with that and build our mitigation strategies around that reality.
Okay, that's schools. What other places do you think we need better solutions as it relates to ventilation, airborne, et cetera?
Believe it or not, hospitals. So hospitals have the highest quality filtration, which is the HEPA filter. But we still have people wearing those surgical masks, those blue surgical masks, the ones that are baggy tops and bottoms on the side. If you go in for any kind of medical procedure wearing an N95, they will tell you at the hospital, take that off and put on this crappy, lesser quality mask, which is infuriating. And that's just their policy. So what we need is to have N95 quality respirators worn across the board in hospitals where people are most likely to be infected and infectious. So yeah, that's a strange one, but I would count hospitals as being a place that needs to look at their infection practice and control measures a bit more closely.
While we're on that subject, can you tell me why they do that? Why you can walk in? I've done it myself. I've walked into the hospital to get a PCR test. I'm wearing a brand new N95 mask. I walk in the door. They say, take that off, and they hand me a cloth mask, and they say, put this on instead. Why do they do that?
Yeah, I've asked them, and the answer I get is twofold. One is, we can't be sure that your mask is good, just we have your word for it. And the second is, some people have an allergy, perhaps, to the mask that you're bringing in. I don't really buy either one of those arguments. I think it's more adherence to the letter of a rule that someone wrote, and someone's afraid to break the rules.
Okay, I know you're not a political scientist, but I'm going to ask you a political question anyway. Because we have seen, obviously, in the United States, the simple act of mask wearing is well beyond a public health issue. It has become a political issue in a major way. In your travels in this country, do you see that?
To a lesser extent. And there is, if you have a Venn diagram of the COVID deniers, the anti-vaxxers, and the anti-maskers, it's almost a perfect circle. There's going to be some overlap. Obviously, not all people who are vaccine hesitant share these beliefs, for example, but there is a large overlap. So I think it comes from a political viewpoint that holds independent individual freedoms as the highest possible value. And I can respect some of that to some extent, but it ignores the fact there are community responsibilities that come with our freedoms. And I think we're going to have a few years of deep introspection in this country to establish what really are the fundamental Canadian values. Do we value community well-being above the sacrosanct nature of individual rights? I think we do.
That's Dr. Raywat Deonandan, epidemiologist and global health researcher at the University of Ottawa, whose visits to our program we really do appreciate. Thanks so much and take good care.
Thank you so much.
The Agenda with Steve Paikin is made possible through generous philanthropic contributions from viewers like you. Thank you for supporting TVO's journalism.